So, I'm Andrew McMillan, and she's more than expected to be here, I guess. I'm going to talk about some of the things that we do to use Debian packages in maybe interesting and perhaps unplanned ways to do some, help us do some systems administration things. I'm sure that most of us have been in this situation, having a bunch of accounts, you know, on a bunch of different systems, and then needing to do things across a lot of systems. So, you know, you often end up writing a script like this.
Yeah, you have to as well.
Yeah. you know, there kind of has to be a better way. There's some problems with that thing. You know, the names of all these machines are named after philosophers, but one of them got spelled wrong. And you know, just after a couple of minutes, I couldn't actually name that list of systems. And in fact, when I made it up, I got quite a few of them wrong. So, it doesn't scale very well. If we have, maybe it's okay with 10 or 12 systems, but if it's 20 or 40 or 100, it gets a lot harder. It doesn't cope very well with complexly firewalled systems, where perhaps you can't SSH indirectly. You have to maybe SSH forward through a couple of machines to get to it, deep on client networks or something like that. I wrote another shell script to make it easier to SSH through deeply firewalled machines and so on, but it was getting a little bit silly. So we did some thinking about how we could do it better. I'm Debian development, so maybe I could write a Debian package to do some of these things. And all of these systems were Debian systems, or almost all of them. So I started to come up with some other ideas. There's other things to consider as well in this. You know, there's centralized management approaches like FAI, which indeed we use, and LDAP for authentication and so on. But these approaches tend to be quite concentrated in the center, and if LDAP is great, or Kerberos or something is great, if you've got a centrally accessible machine which you can consider the place where authentication happens. But what happens if you're trying to maintain a machine and the network is down to your centralized host is down or something, and you're trying to solve this problem? How can you log onto the machines when you don't have that authentication? So trying to use that centralized approach was going to be too expensive. You know, you need backup links, you need backup machines, so the cost just turns exponential all of a sudden. So we came up with the idea of using a Debian package for user management. So we wrapped me in a box, shipped me out, and so the Debian package installs, creates a user account, puts my SSH key in there, and so on, and so we can production line. It went on. So, okay, I created a Debian package for myself. Then you know, we went further beyond that. We started creating Debian packages for everybody at Catalyst, and then creating meta packages so that we have groups of users. So we've got Catalyst systems administrators installs, you know, these five people and conflicts with these people who've resigned and things like that. And it sort of starts to work quite well. So there's a bunch of other, you know, uses for standardization of systems and so on that they could also use the Debian packages for. The meta packages that we're using for our systems administrators Very simple. All they contain is a list of packages they depend on or conflict with, and you can do that. You know, for example, nobody at Catalyst seems to like using Nano, regardless of it being the damn thing that gets installed by default on all of our systems. So, you know, somebody sort of adds a conflicts with Nano into their package. And we also use it for packages that do things like all of the necessary scripting to do Apache node file analysis in a way that fits our standard environment, things like that. And then once we've got all these Debian packages on there, we need to be able to manage the systems to know what packages, what versions of everything are installed. So we came up with a system for gathering host information. Essentially, it gathers package versions, names, and so on. And then it sort of grew a bit, added a bit more hardware and so on, and hardware analysis and detection. Then we took it a bit further, started building our applications, so that when we build applications for clients, we build them as Debian packages. So we get straight into the New Zealand electoral roll, for example, which is across about 30 or so servers. Various packages for the database server side of the application, for the middleware layers on various servers, for the front-end layers. So our whole the whole application ends up being packaged, and if we have to move it across to a new cluster of machines at some point, we can just apt-get install the electoral roll and it's all going. So we've extended that a lot. So we use that a lot for much more application-y management. These aren't Debian packages in the sense of the packages that are in Debian, because these are for internal use. We don't insist that everything has a man page. It's not all that useful to have a man page for a website. But it's still useful to have them being installable using apt-get, and we run repositories to hold them in and so on. So this is what a Catalyst user package looks like. Installs an account skeleton, you know, the things that people generally want when they set up an account on a machine. Bash RC, Vim RC, authorized keys. Then it creates an account when you install the package, and it generates a random password for the account, and GPG encrypts it, and either it just saves it in a local file in that account, or it emails it off to the person concerned. That's kind of their choice. Then when the package is deleted, so if you go apt-get remove package, it disables the account but doesn't remove any of the data, and then if you go apt-get purge, it removes the account data completely. That's sort of model seems to work quite well. If you've got something that conflicts, it gets deleted, not purged, so you can upgrade packages and packages will get deleted, but the data that may be important is still left there. The host information system that we use also has a package that gets installed on every machine at Catalyst, so we have that sends an email to a centralised database every night, and we can query it. And if anybody's interested, I can show you what that looks like at the moment. So we can query package versions and hardware versions and partitioning information, IP addresses and things like that. So looking at this a bit further, you've kind of got to consider what are the security implications of taking this approach. You have to trust the person making the package, so these user packages aren't generally made by the general users of Catalyst, they're made by the systems administrators who have full access to the systems concerned in any case. Because there's, you know, what goes in the package. These, of course, when you install a package, the scripts that are installing it run as root, so potentially a person has full control over the machine while their package is being installed, so it's a source for, you know, Trojan privilege escalations and like that. But you also have to recognize that whenever you install a package on your machine, that's happening. You have to trust everybody within Debian who creates a package that you're going to install on your machine, because you're giving them root the whole time. Which is pretty dodgy. I don't know, there's some pretty dodgy characters around. What I want to do in the future is to turn these scripts into something so that you can go make user package and it'll pull down a template and basically create you the basics of a user package, and then you can build it and use it for yourself. And I also want to create a make meta package script that will just give a list of dependencies and a list of conflicts on the command line, and it will just create a meta package. I think they're very useful and they should be kind of more accessible. Feel free to ask questions too if you've got any.
What's your version number?
My version number?
Yeah, just curious. Your version number, so to say.
The version number of my package, I think, is 21.
just like Linux.
Yeah.
Have you got any RC bugs on yourself?
Yeah, lots.
Yeah. Are you suitable for release?
I forgot.
Yeah, I was thinking about uploading it into the Debian repository and just seeing who installed it. The host information system that we have is currently client and master packages. So the client package gets installed on every machine, and that sends the information about the machine back to the central point. And then the master package is the website that you can browse it with. And hopefully I'll make these two packages available publicly before the end of the year.
What information is sending back?
Sending back IP addresses, the LSPCI kind of output, the partition table, and some free space information. Well, you don't use this for monitoring free space information or things like that. This is sort of static information about it, so amounts and mount points. The users, the groups, and the most important and most useful thing we do is the list of installed Debian packages. And their versions.
Every so often, then
does it? Daily, yeah. We configure it to run daily.
So it's kind of personalized popcorn in a certain sense.
Sorry?
It's a kind of internal use personalized popcorn, like with some more information and list of
sort of. Sort of. It's not really a popcorn, because popcorn is really just tracking the numbers of machines using this package and less version-related information. So I'll show it to you in a minute. There's only a few more slides here, so maybe I'll show it through.
On the server side, it's not like popcorn. I mean, on the client side, it's just something that...
On the client side, it's similar to popcorn, yeah, but on the server side, it's quite different. Sorry, that was actually the end. So, I guess I'm interested in what other people have done in this sort of area, and probably you guys are too, because you're here. So, does anybody want to share their experiences doing this sort of thing as well?
Some similar thing that can set up with precinct files, things like that. So, to install a new server on my end, my procedure, server with what software I want as the basis and configure it the way I like it. Very similar from what is doing with meta package or things like that. Meta package for all the software I need on my machine. Meta package specialized for server. Meta package specialized for software to detect network problems and things like that. What I'm now trying to do more, and I would like to share experiences, package carrying configuration information. What I mean is, I install something, I don't like very well how it is configured by default. I want to install next package to configure that program. What I'm doing now is using scripts and patches. I work around dpatch to make it patching the system from the root, so I can patch any file that is inside the machine with dpatch.
Right.
Now if you're not doing anything around with this package with configuration information.
We use a centralized LLAP setup still for our users, and so we have to configure each host to change the panel information to actually look at the LLAP. And so currently, yeah, we are kind of doing the same. So we add an extra package which changes the panel information and the lib NSS and the lib NSS LLAP, not the lib LLAP.
Are you sharing that configuration?
Yeah, we inject it later to LLAPify the host and run it into our LLAP network. It's similar. But yeah, we don't have user metadata. This is adding this personalizing your own. Because yeah, it's kind of a combination of using LLAP and having your home directory in some version control system and updating. I mean, it's kind of a combination.
Kind of, yeah. I mean, the main reason we didn't go with an LDAP sort of solution is the problem that many of these machines are located at clients' offices on a client's local area network. And so, you know, and many of them are located on the internet or, you know, so we have strongly partitioned client networks. So for one client, we'll have like a firewall that's on the internet, and then a bunch of layers of machines and firewalls behind that until you come into the database set, which is usually just about impossible to get to straightforwardly. Yeah,
we have a centralized setup, so that's how.
In a lot of organisations, say a university or something like that, you're going to have a lot more possibilities for doing centralized.
Except that it doesn't have user metadata like your HRC and stuff that's not supported, only setting your shell.
Right.
So how does the callback work? How does it send information back? HTTP, email?
Email. Yeah. All of the machines have to be able to send email that we're setting up, just because there's a lot of systems administration tasks that can happen over email. So if a cron job goes wrong, cron expects to be able to send an email for the error. You know, so all of our machines have to be able to send email. They don't all have to have access to HTTP for a site or something like that. And we generally don't want this information to be... we don't want it to be hard to access internally. So there's no authentication on this. So I'm actually on a VPN, so I can actually get onto the site and show it to you.
For answering your question, I'm in the standard profession. And we start all the data from my PC and I want to share information and don't waste my time in the configuration type everywhere. So in fact, I use two things. I use a meta package which contains all package dependency that I want to install on each PC by class. So there is a desktop one, desktop desktop X86, desktop AMD 64, and all this kind of thing. I install it. But it just takes packages. Works quite well, but with unstable, is a problem that from time to time breaks because the package which is not up to date or something like that. It breaks the main package. You have to uninstall the main package. You remember to reinstall it from the breakage from the queue. So it's quite uneasy. You just have to do a checkpoint package to synchronize the host for unstable at the same time when nothing is broken. So pretty complicated. And for the configuration file, I use Puppet, which is like CF engine. Works pretty well. You have a central repository. You don't have to be connected every time. You just have to be connected once. And once you get this, if you can connect, let's say, once in a week, you access the Puppet central repository, you pull many configuration files, and you configure your system. You can run script, etc. It's pretty well done. I think it's a little bit memory consuming, but well, why not? And I've got also a script to extract LDAP user account and create accounts using Puppet for the stuff. And well, so it works. And well, I have
just a moment. I don't not using CF engine probably because some problem we have is too centralized.
Yes.
In my team there are many people, but everyone manage their machines differently. So
yes.
I try to avoid centralized way because another thing that's happened is there is centralized, there is someone responsible, and to finish the installation on machine I ask somebody else, oh, make this change to FCF engine to finish my machine. That's why I want to avoid. Only thing centralized well have is a repository of my personal package. Nothing I'd like to avoid.
Well, if you put your CF engine or whatever configuration in a remote control system, then everybody can make it on. You don't need to have someone to be the gatekeeper.
But
if you want to scale.
Yes, yeah, no, but singularly. I use stable my servers, all my college use testing and stable. So it would be a little danger.
Yes,
to
but you can manage class. I mean that, for example, let's say Wittgenstein is a host you're running unstable. You can use the class unstable in Puppet, for example, and you will get only changes for unstable. Your configuration file tag unstable, and you will only install this. You can also put dependency on package gestion, for example. You can just say this part of the configuration apply only if you've got the package which is upper than the gestion, and you can do a pretty, pretty precise thing. You can also have file buckets, I think. It's called file buckets, which in fact, if the file is there, you can backup the file which was the original file you erase in the central repository and get this. And you can do very little for people who want to manage most of their machine. You can do only the little part of NFS mount or I don't know or NSS switch configuration, NSSL configuration, etc. You can just do this and then manage the rest of the machine, and you've got no problem. You can really define a pair node configuration, and you can really have no action in.
That's better than I was thinking.
Puppet is very modularized. You can basically define your own set of modules. So for your machines, you can just say, I want to use these modules and add the modules together so that you basically, you define modules. And so you can say, this server needs this set of modules, that server needs that set of modules. So it's very customizable.
Yeah, not so much a question, but a comment. The company I work in has about 200 machines, most of them. Many of them Solaris, so we can't install this approach. We recently started using Puppet. We have some scalability problems with it. Basically, the server is single threaded and doesn't scale as much machines with as much file service as we would like to function using Puppet. But Puppet is quite nice. The problem we have with it is that a single run, which happens every so often, depending on the machine, maybe, has to find out about everything and fetch the configuration of everything compare it all and then apply the changes. So it's not possible to do a quick fix like apply this change to these machines now. With this approach, it's possible because when you upload the package and then have all the machines done completely.
Yeah, as it stands, we host about, we've probably got about 400, 450 machines that we're using this approach for, but with the approach as it is now, I think we are probably reaching the effective limits of that scalability. But to go beyond that, we would have to start automatically upgrading our Debian packages, you know, so the machines were configured with Chromapt or something like that.
So we're still doing this manually?
We still do this manually, yeah. We don't run a sanitized Debian repository, which I think we would also need to do. So we need to have a Debian repository where we controlled what packages came through into it, just to ensure that we don't roll out something across 400 machines and get some sort of regression.
Just curious, do you know DSH, Dunsop shell?
The
DSH. It's a shell written by, I think, Junichi Urokawa?
Yeah, would be.
It does things in parallel.
Right. I don't actually do any of the systems administration any longer, but I think that the guys probably do look at tools like that. They will do. Certainly, we manage it as the 400 of our machines with 7 systems administrators. So it's a good standard of time. This is the host info system, which is probably a little bit crude because it's an internal system. But you can list some of the hosts there, and hopefully I've still got any network connection. Or maybe I don't. Oh yeah. So you can see the various hosts that are there, how much RAM there is. The host info system actually supports Solaris and OpenBSD as well, which is why it's got a column there that says Linux.
Can you click on one?
Click on a host? Sure. So click on a host there, and that drills down to give us the primary
password.
There is no password for the system. It's information only, and it's only available on our LAN and across the VPN to Edinburgh. So you get some basic information, you know, Linux, 500 meg RAM, it's running Sarge, then you get to see the packages that are installed. So here's one, baseconfig. It's not up to date, and the latest version that it sees on a Sarge machine is a peculiar version number, 2.53.10. So it's parsing the version number to try and return what the latest version of the Debian package is across many hosts. It's quite tricky because of the complicated nature of the Debian version number and string.
You don't use dpackage compare?
Well, you can't use dpackage compare very efficiently when you're listing, say, 1,000 packages on one machine. I'm sure dpackage compare would do it correctly, but we've had to try and re-implement
so slow. DTPO calls it n times.
Most of the time, this gets it right. So, so that says 3.0.7 is installed on, and it says what machine it's installed on. I can also click on a. Here's one that's been uninstalled, Catalyst Chris Hodges. I can click on that one. He's a systems administrator with its design. And I can see what machines he's installed on, and thankfully they're all kind of greyed out, which is good because he doesn't work for us anymore. So it hasn't been purged, but it's been deleted.
Woody.
Woody. There might be a machine still running Woody. Sometimes these have the version.
Do you really want this?
No.
Do you really want this machine?
Probably. Probably not.
You should have said that earlier.
I should have said, yeah. No. It's not. I mean, that's not that critical. You can probably discover that remotely if you wanted to. So it can be quite useful in here. So if we want to look at a kernel, see if there's anything running in 2.4 kernel, we can find that there are things. So, you know, if we had something that we wanted to particularly resolve around 2.4 kernels, we would, you know, just be able to pull those machines out. Similarly, if we wanted to say what's running 2.6.20, we would sort of find out that there's those machines running 2.6.20. And so that's the packages. It's got hard disk information that it shows. So, yeah. Oops. Screen is so small I can't actually have got all the other things. LSPCI, so you can find out that this is a fairly thorough kind of Intel.
And you can compare host names, what do you use?
Yeah, comparing host names.
Hosts, I mean.
Hosts, so yeah, in the list hosts screen, you can kind of checkbox.
But what do you use this for example?
Well, if you've got two machines that are supposed to be doing the same role, they should really have quite a similar set of packages installed on them.
So there's a package diff then?
Sorry?
There's a diff of the installed packages and... maybe you can share it.
A little easier to show.
Yeah.
Actually, if I pick I might get some machines that I know should actually be quite similar. So say we pick E-Series P-AMP2, E-Series P-AMP1, and then compare those, I should get... So I get them side by side, and you can see which ones are...
So it's no difference here.
So there's some differences there. So FAI client is slightly different. FPIN is slightly different.
Maybe it would be useful for this to be able to collapse the differences, the similarities.
I think that it can. Maybe.
For now, it just puts it side by side.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Which gets a bit useless when you've got 20 machines, but you don't really compare to
them. Is there any prior or confidential information in the Debian packages? For example, I have a bunch of meta packages for my systems, which include some passwords, for example, to be able to update the dynamic DNS information for the host. And I would like to put the source package for all the stuff in the public repository, but of course I don't want to include the
the key there.
Yeah.
I don't mind having it in the binary page. Like I can just put it in the VPN or whatever. So, do you have any experience or some else have some ideas how to do that on build time or putting the key encrypted in the source and typing the GPG on build time or whatever?
Anything to do with that sort of stuff is really, I can't see the packaging as a great idea.
In Argentina itself, we use something like this to make SSL handshaking, and we make it with a one-time password, that password that can use one time. The client requests the password to the server and make a phone call, and we in the phone call available to him and give the one-time password.
Yeah, okay,
and
so
they put it in
there. Some memory intervention required.
Yeah, because we need to have different certificates for each person.
Yeah. Well, these are just for personal use, so just hide it somewhere. Just wanted to know if someone has something like this.
What kind of information is it? I mean,
so it's a standard password across all systems.
If it's a key, it's not the public key in
the end, it's the private part for the public key to be updated, to be able to update the ES information.
Oh,
okay. I don't use a separate key for any client, just put the app.
Okay.
I said just wanted to distribute it using Debian packages, and there the problem that it's visible.
But you always will need a manual activity because you need to distinguish which clients do you want to have the password and which clients do you want to have the password.
Those who have the binary package will have the password, yes. But that's a different kind of issue. That's just in my VPN.
Yeah, but if you put it in an easily copied file.
Yeah, I know that there's some problems with that.
Yeah.
You have an automatic build process?
Not really. No.
Because you can inject the passwords in the build process.
Yes. As the question was how to do that.
I mean, like, what's the difference between having it in the binary package or in the source package? Right?
The source package would be on the public internet.
Oh, okay. But
we
should. Those put it there.
We just take it off there.
Why not manually build that package? And doing multi-insert secret part.
Or having many rules that fetch the key from somewhere.
Yeah.
And then from in the source package you document that. To build this, you need to put the right somewhere.
Yeah.
If you're not using VPN, I think it's better than distributing even by encrypted. Problem why? It's useless for people outside, and
yes, and it's useful just for public, for private use. So that won't us to.
But why don't you want it on the internet?
Just because. Let's take it.
Yeah.
Because few problems with this kind of approach. When a different package touch the configuration of another package, upgrade cry in the next upgrade because one script just changed the configuration of the. Do you have experience with that?
So packages that have the same script in both of them, or something like that.
My apologies.
Packages that have the same script in both, where the same script, the same file is in both packages, so you get a conflict between.
Well,
what it means is that if you have a meta package which needs to alter the configuration on the system in general by altering configuration files which belong to our packages. Which you can't, there's really, in my experience, there's really nothing you can do except the equal.
Right, but if there's a personal package, it's totally easy. Yeah.
And you can talk to the Debian edu/Linux people who have.
You can
pre-see experience with that. You can
the problem is not
this, but if
I think I understand your problem.
The problem is not with that conference, with that conference. The problem is if I just patch a configured
file. You will ask. I find a way. When I install the change by patching, before I do upgrades, I reverse the patches, do the upgrade, and reinstall the patches. Most of the time, just works.
How do you do that?
I modify the patch with my script that since the source of a Debian package is slash. So I have a script that installs all the patches using the patch and configures something like 10 files.
Well, supposedly, no package will change the configuration in ways of upgrade.
That's why it is a script outside of the package. And one of the things I violate policies, when I upgrade my package, it first reverses all the patches. I put a new version of the script, and then manually I reinstall my updates, my configuration.
So if the other package upgrades,
it's a problem. I should try to reverse the patch. But sometimes
the problem is not with your upgrade. The problem is when the original package upgraded. Because in that case, the original package says, oh, my configuration file was touched by a script.
No problem.
What should I do?
You can do things. You can not upgrade, and after, you upgrade package but not touch the file and manually resolve the conflicts. Or before you upgrade your package, you run my script that do the upgrade with // revert. So it reverts all the patches, do the upgrade, as the file seems to be as the original, as the patch was removed, you can do a clean upgrade and reinstall the patches.
This is a very complex upgrade process. This is not upgrade.
The only problem is during a security update, I forget to reverse the patches. That's the only problem.
But usually it works. It's really not supposed to do weird things like upgrade.
They will occasionally.
Yes.
The first time you see, maybe just changing a very very bad default or something like that, or the infamous sudo change from 2 years ago or whatever. We just redid everything.
I don't think I did sudo 2 years ago.
We should have that.
Okay. Well, that sort of problem really needs a rethink of the config file system.
Yeah, or just
in my opinion, really should be removed and replaced by something different.
Well, I think it's okay for Debian packages that you shouldn't mess with other people's packages, but there should be some way for local packages that
or
to
that,
mess cleanly with other files.
That is true, but then you should have some sort of a
premium
tag these packages as being configuration packages, maybe, or.
And you need some hooks to be able to deploy the changes.
Yeah, I'm looking for the stuff. That's
exactly the question.
And what they are trying to do with CDD is too much complex and will take too much time to have many levels of configurations. It means to change many packages. And I want something fast for now. I need this now, I'm using this now. So, yes, you need
quick. In my particular case, I can't wait. This is not the problem. But I don't know. I installed Snort, and now I install a package to modify the Snort configuration.
Yes.
When Snort will be upgraded, Snort cries and says, I don't know what to do.
For our package that configures Snort, have a comment to reverse the configuration. If you can't reverse the modification, you can cleanly upgrade Snort.
And
I try
should modify
to
the Snort package for do that.
Sorry?
I should modify the Snort package for do that. To do that, I should need to modify the Snort package.
No, it's the opposite. You stop Snort, you have your package to fine-tune Snort to your way, right?
I repeat, my English is bad. Sorry.
You have a package to fine-tune Snort, to configure Snort on your way, right?
Mm-hmm.
You add an extra switch to reverse the configuration. You understand? If you have the ability to reverse your change, you can cleanly update Snort.
Yeah, but you have to do it manually.
Yes.
Unless you have some
really question is how to
the sensors of this net it's a very large net and they run upgrade in a current file. No human intervention.
No problem. You are about to upgrade, you reverse all the changes, upgrade and reapply the changes.
Yeah, but you can't do that and then restart everything.
No. When I reverse, I don't restart the service. They'll still try running with the old configuration. Just when I reapply my changes, and that's only when I restart all the daemons. So this use the new configuration.
The daemons will restart on upgrade with the unpatched version.
But this is the same as I was installing cleanly. They will start again with the configuration I don't want. So, yes, it's not good, but.
Something that I've done for changes that I want is to just put the absolute smallest bit of change into the package and then have your whatever extra configuration somewhere else. So if you can include something, you add an include line, or if you can call out to a script somewhere else, you add a call out to the script somewhere else. And those sort of changes usually much more reliably apply.
The package should really do three-way diffs of config files.
Did for some time.
If you use UCF,
it does. UCF does three-way diffs.
Every package should use UCF.
Another possibility you have with often found with our package, it sounds really evil, but your smart update thing could, more than modifying the Snort config, also modifying the pre-RM. So
the pre-RM?
Yeah, the pre-RM script.
Pre-RM.
Pre-remove.
But that's evil, I mean. I'm not really meaning to say that it should do that.
I really don't want to touch the packages as Debian gives us, because they have security patches. I just put the security patch to my package.
No, but the point is, if after installation you modify both the config and the installed version of the pre-RM, you're kind of safe and you haven't modified the package. It's a hack.
it's evil, yes. That's a nice idea.
That's it, I mean.
Okay, well, we're out of time. So I hope that's been useful and entertaining discussion for everyone.
That's your package, that's your Macmillan package public.
Can I call you and lunch?
Sure. You trust me. I can give you a touch easy, which is just the framework.
Okay.
But
just one final question: what doesn't work with your network?
What doesn't work? It won't scale without some serious rethinking about automatic.
But is that only the problem with launching the upgrade?
I'm sorry?
I mean, is the only problem launching the upgrade? If you move it to Chrome, will it scale more? Or?
Yeah, if you move it to Chrome, it will scale more, yeah. But you've got to trust the repository of packages a lot more to be able to do that. And so to trust the package repository a lot more, you have to have something like a testing environment and so on. We have a very diverse set of equipment and catalysts too, so these machines have different kernel configurations on them. We pretty much always end up building our own kernels for machines. It would be better if we would cut down on our addiction to that.
You could probably to update the catalyst packages.
Yeah, you could do something like that, I guess. Be specific about. Yeah. We could.